Can you hear me? Perfect. So it works.
Anju, if I speak in the microphone, can you hear me? Just let me know in the chat.
Like this? Switch it off. Does it work? Morning. Considering we only have 60 minutes, I think we should be starting slowly. Katarina, could you close the door? Thank you. Sorry. Okay, anyway. Good morning. Welcome to Paris. Good morning to everybody here in Paris, but also good morning or afternoon or evening to all of us joining us remotely. And I know, at least if it goes for the speakers, that we have people joining us from very far away. It's a disadvantage to have the session on the day one in the morning, so I'm afraid this has affected the participation here in the room, but that it's not a sign that the topic that we are about to discuss is not worthwhile and crucial and important for us to tackle. Before we dive in, I would just like to give you a little bit of context. First of all, my name is Teresa Horejsova. I'm from Diplo Foundation, also working on the Geneva Internet Platform project. And I have been involved in capacity development programs for a couple of years now. And when working on that alongside my colleague, we have realized that there are so many kind of practical challenges that are not really dealt with. As you know, and our director, Jovan Kurbalia, often says it, that if you're writing a speech and you don't know what to put in to spice it up a little bit, put capacity development, because that never goes wrong. You can always spice it up with capacity development because everybody will agree with it, everybody will be happy because everybody agrees that capacity development activities in digital policy, which is the context we are covering here, is needed. However, what I feel, and many of you around here through our discussions I know are feeling the same way, is some kind of a disconnect between the proclamations, the things that everybody thinks should be done, and the very practical issues. How should it be done? How to avoid unnecessary competition while, while at the same time having meaningful participation and cooperation among actors providing capacity development programs, how to complement each other. How to even tackle the very sensitive issues of financing capacity development programs, because while everybody says that capacity development programs are needed, the little detail of how capacity development programs should be paid are sometimes neglected. Should it be a responsibility of those that are receiving capacity development activities? Is it responsibility of governments, the international community, private donors? We don't know, and nobody seems to be taking that responsibility, and maybe not a single group should be taking the responsibility. How to make capacity development programs really impactful, that we don't have a hooray, you know, one-off action that might have some immediate impact these are some of the questions that we have been talking about, both informally, in Diplo, and with many of you around, but that we have also tried to bring this discussion to various international fora. So some months ago, we had a session at the WSIS, at the World Summit on Information Society in Geneva. Some of you in this room actually participated in this session where we kind of tried to take this discussion to the higher level, to open up issues that not everybody wants to speak about. We then continued in Toronto at the RightsCon conference. And finally, we are now here in Paris bringing it to the Internet Governance Forum. Excuse me. At the Internet Governance Forum, you know that there is a capacity development track, so I think this discussion definitely belongs here. Before I turn to some of the resource people that are here around the room, I would also like to introduce my colleague Marco Lotti, who is our bridge with the remote participants and remote speakers. So while we are having this discussion, we will do our best to involve also people that are joining us from other parts of the world and couldn't travel to Paris. And I would also like to introduce Katarina Höhne, who is also from Diplo Foundation. Katarina is reporting from this session. Just a little caveat at the beginning, Diplo is covering every single session at the Internet Governance Forum, and reports will be available on our Digital Watch Observatory, usually within 2 hours after the session is finished. So if you miss this or another session, you're more than welcome to refer to our reporting. So before I ask our resource people, I would just like to turn to some of you here in the room, or of course remotely, if based on the intro that I've given and the context, this is also your thinking, or what are some of the kind of concrete challenges that you in your work are facing. And if you take the floor, if you can just say who you are and where you're from. Okay, Dustin, thank you. Let me switch this first.
Well, thank you, Teresa, for organizing this panel again after the successful panel we had at RightsCon. And I just wanted to touch on a few of the things that you mentioned. I think one is looking at other capacity developments, initiatives, not as competition. I think really what drives that feeling of competition is the funding aspect, because you know, there's only so much funding to go around, but our work actually complements each other well if we kind of take that element out of it. So I should introduce myself. My name is Dustin Phillips. I work with ICANN-Wiki, and we are a separate entity from the Internet Corporation of Assigned Names and Numbers. We are privately funded through mostly corporate sponsorships and memberships. And we have, if you're involved in the ICANN community, you've likely heard about some of the issues that we've had around funding recently. For a while, we were funded by the ICANN organization, and recently that funding has been diminished as part of their larger organizational budget cuts. So this is an issue that's, you know, particularly close to home, and you know, it brings a few thoughts to mind. One being who is responsible for the funding element of capacity development. And I think, you know, you touched on this, but it's no one actor. It should be spread out amongst foundations, corporate entities, and it's also important for the people running these initiatives to keep the sustainability in mind as they kind of think about the continuity of the project. So, you know, especially when it comes to grants and sponsorships, a lot of times once a project's over, the funding runs dry and you risk losing all of the work that you've done. And that is one thing that we are struggling with, trying to keep the project alive, but also preserving 13 years of work. It's less about, you know, keeping a job for myself and more about protecting this work that the community has provided for 13 years. And so I think we have set ourselves up in a good way because our content is community sourced. It's much like Wikipedia is, where anybody can come and contribute, and we've put a lot of work in over the years to make it even easier than it is to contribute on Wikipedia using various tools like the visual editor and different forms that speed that process along. But you know, other than that, I think it's just, you know, owning the responsibility to keep the project going, but also not doing so in a way that takes away from the product you want to provide, because when you look at profitability, that doesn't always align with the what's actually best for the people that you're trying to serve. So that's a really tough issue to grapple with, and one that we're dealing with now. So
thank you, Dustin. I think really what you brought also comes close to home to us. I would say that there are also these various aspects of responsibility, first of all, of the donors when they start supporting a project that is meant to be of a longer duration and there is a discontinuation, it can have quite a catastrophic impact. On the other hand, we have to accept, I think, that also for many donors, priorities change, and therefore the only suggestion that I would have in this regard for any organization is try to have diversified sources of funding to be able to follow the mission and the activities to the largest extent possible, because putting everything on one card is always very, very tricky. And I certainly hope that IcanWiki is such a crucial project for the community, you know, will continue despite the challenges. Thank you. About the competition, I think, you know, some of us might tackle that as well. It is also very practical issues, because yes, we are competing for the same funding in many cases, but at the same time, I think every organization has a specific niche and approach, and you know, if we reasonably and smartly try to complement each other, things can only go well. If there are any other issues from the room or from our remote, not at this moment yet. Please, Lara.
Hi. Good morning, Teresa, and thank you. I think I completely agree with the thing with the challenge of competition and how do you secure sustainable funding, and you know, trying to address the challenge of fundraising and not risking being the job justifier kind of endeavor. But I think if we have to change the perspective and think about impact. So what is it that we mean by impact? And if we as a community can start to not define it, but if we can agree what we all think is impact, I think the challenge about competition and the challenge about securing continuous funding becomes automatic, because I think donors are always looking for impact, but we talk about impact, but we don't really understand what it means, because it's such a broad term. So I'd be very keen to see that sort of flip of the argument.
Thank you. This was Lara Pach. I learned the right pronunciation of your surname just before the session. What about for the donors, and maybe Alberto, I can just quickly turn to you on this. For donors, is it, and Jorge, is it more interesting for you to fund projects which are implemented by multiple partners? Maybe, you know, building on what Lara said, that when you have various partners putting their forces together, complementing each other to develop a certain project, or maybe is it actually easier for you to just work with one? Because, you know, there again comes this kind of very practical issue. It just came on my mind that it would be good to hear your views on this.
Shall I just directly answer your question? I'm Alberto Cerda. I work at Thor Foundation. I'm the Global Program Officer for Internet Rights and Access at the Foundation. My work is basically supporting organizations working in developing countries in digital policy with a human rights and a social justice perspective. One of the challenges for us in particular, and I suspect that that's the case for most American foundations that are working in this field, is the fact that we are subject to US law and to the IRS, the tax administration, that makes a lot of requirements regarding to the kind of initiatives that we can support and exclude certain kind of organizations, exclude certain kind of people. And that is particularly tricky, difficult when you are trying to work with overseas organizations, because naturally they are not constituting the US, they are not establishing the US, they don't meet necessarily US standards, and it makes difficult to do grant making with them. Most of the time when we work with organizations based on overseas countries, in countries other than the US, we start with project support, because their status by laws doesn't allow them to get general support or support. As we build relations with them, we try to help them in the process of normalizing their status to become what we call legally equivalent to a US nonprofit, and that allows us to provide them general core or in some cases even organizational support. In my case, I have been at the foundation for 4 years, and today around a half of my portfolio, I'm working with 30 organizations in 15 different countries, is based on general support, which is much more useful than just for the specific project, especially when you are trying to seize political opportunities that they last for just a couple of weeks, sometimes a couple of months, and that's it. But it's still challenging to do it in certain countries. Just some examples. In many countries, there is no specific status for nonprofits, for civil society organizations. Every single nonprofit is actually a corporate for social responsibility, which is not equivalent to US status. And as a result, we cannot operate with general support with these kind of organizations. We have to do it through project support. And I completely agree with the fact that the continuity of the work is relevant. I myself was a volunteer for Foundation many years ago, and at some point I became an orphan for Foundation precisely because of the change of priorities and also the change of the people. A lot of the organizations, the foundations are a lot of the foundations are based on the capacities that their professional staff has at hand. And if they lost the professional capacities in the organizations, they lost the capacities for the whole organization, and as a result, it's very difficult to keep the relations. But I have the perception that over the course of the year, particularly for Foundation, we have made significant improvements. Today, almost 40% of our budget is spent to provide organizational support. It means support for the organizations to become stronger, rather than for the specific project. And the remaining 60%, I will say that approximately 40 to 50% of the remaining resources are spent in general support. We're trying to reduce the use of project support because it's extremely challenging, because it doesn't necessarily help the organizations in the long term, and it doesn't help us also, us, strategically speaking.
Thank you. I can assure you that also for those doing capacity development programs, core support is always preferred, because it's also a sign of trust to continue and pursue the mission that the organization has, and enables the organization to further, you know, develop the project and seek partnerships with others to make the real impact. Jorge, maybe quickly on this. This is Jorge Cancio from the Swiss Federal Office of Communications. You're also from the donor perspective. How do you see this, like working on specific projects with multiple organizations? I know that many of your projects are of this kind.
Thank you so much, Teresa. This is Jorge Cancio from the Swiss government. As a sort of introduction, I guess I would need to say that coming from the Office of Communications, we are not really in the business of giving support to specific projects. That's something that is being done by our partners, our colleagues in the agency on development cooperation, and of course there they have lots of projects that touch on ICT for development, and they have been active there for a long time. From our point of view, and from government's perspective, you are of course bound by law. That's really very tricky sometimes, because you have to find the legal basis to support a project. And on the other side, of course, you have to convince your political supervisors that that project w- when you have found that legal basis is really worth supporting. And in general, I think that from the Swiss perspective in the field of internet governance and information society, we have been very eager to take part in this many times in cooperation with our colleagues from the Foreign Affairs Department, who have, let's say, more clear legal basis or more clear specific budgets for doing this, because as a small country which is highly connected, we are really dependent on having other people, other colleagues from other countries and also from a civil society, from the private sector, engaging and being able to engage in these multi-stakeholder discussions. That's why we were funding or organizing the first WISIS in 2003, giving seed funding to the IGF in the early days when it was starting. And of course, then we also try to walk the talk of capacity building. So on digital policy specifically, it's been a, let's say, a joint venture between our Foreign Affairs Department colleagues and ourselves to support initiatives which we thought were important and which were helping other stakeholders, also with a focus on the missions of developing countries and small countries in Geneva, to really be able to take part in these discussions, because as you know, large delegations in Geneva, for instance, for giving just an example, may have more than 100 or more diplomats working there, but small delegations from, for instance, from African countries may have 5, 6, 7 people in total, with the ambassador included, and one person is covering all the specialized agencies. So you really have to provide them with the tools to empower them to take part in such projects. And going to your question in particular, let's say that from our point of view, and this is a very pragmatic approach to the question, is a lot of what we are providing in support for digital policy capacity building is through the GIP, the Geneva Internet Platform, because it's, let's say, also a joint venture between Diplo and the Swiss government, and where we try to have a very arm's length relationship with the GIP. Let's say that this is kind of we are kind of the trust who gives the core funding for the project, but we try as much as possible to stay away from the editorial decisions, because the objectivity, neutrality, and also of course the quality of the content and of the activities that the GIP is developing is really a precondition for them to be trustworthy, to be perceived as not tele-directed by the Swiss government. Of course, it gives us also some soft power, and that makes sense. But the basic, the gist of this of this commitment is to really provide with good information, good capacity building tools, the community in Geneva and beyond Geneva of these small and developing countries. And of course, there, if Diplo, who runs the Geneva Internet Platform, sees that there's value in having partnerships for specific activities with different NGOs, with different projects, with different organizations, be it ISOC, be it whatever, be it ICANN, or be it with the IGF Secretariat, depending on what they do. As long as they keep it objective, neutral, and with high quality we want into that, and we really support that. And beyond this, let's say, our core digital policy project, we try to support, as far as our legal basis allows us, other projects with very specific activities, be it funding a lunch, funding the setting up of the transcription in some place. So there we try to be as pragmatic as possible within the Swiss law, which is quite prescriptive. So I leave it by that.
And thank you very much, Jorge, not only for the trust, but also for describing a project that gives this freedom to the implementer. I think many of us around the room have experienced projects from some donors where you have to worry about deliverable 36B, although deliverable 36B or 420A makes no sense in the context. So being able to kind of adjust the priorities that or the activities rather that your organization is working on as developments arise is, I think, absolutely crucial if you want to have an impact. And I know impact is something that my colleague Hanna Slavik from Diplo Foundation wanted to say a few words about. So Hanna, over to you.
Thank you, Teresa. Yes, I wanted to pick up also on what Lara said about impact. So I would like to propose a couple basic elements to start off to move in further in our discussion and to add to the background Teresa provided. Based on Diplo's years of experience in capacity development, research, training. So what I wanted to do is start with a reminder that the ultimate aim of capacity development is long-term and sustainable change. So it doesn't matter whether you have funding, it doesn't matter how much funding, how many people are trained, how many events you organize, how much awareness you raise, or whatever other activities, if it doesn't lead to the long-term and sustainable change for the better in the environment where you're working. So unfortunately, sometimes capacity development activities don't achieve the intended impact for various reasons. This might include lack of local involvement and ownership. So for example, a project may be designed by external experts who lack the knowledge of the local environment, local priorities and needs, or of existing capacity. There might be a lack of trust among project partners. There might be a neglect of elements related to soft capacities. So there's many different reasons that a project might not achieve the intended impact. In other cases, there's a lack of realistic assessment of whether the project has achieved its impact or not. In some cases, this might be due to pressure or perceived pressure from donors to report success rather than to look at failures and to try to adjust based on that. In other cases, it may be more related to the fact that monitoring and evaluation haven't been built into a project from the start. So the project may well be achieving impact or it may not, but we simply don't know, because there isn't actually a good system in place to discover this. So what I wanted to do was leave with a couple proposed solutions. So obviously we can't know from the start whether a project is going to be successful. We have to basically go through a process of trial and error and to learn from each step of the process. But first of all, when we're designing projects, capacity development activities in the cyber field, we can learn from the broader development field, capacity development principles and approaches which have been shown to work well in other environments. So the first thing is to learn from what others are doing in capacity development and not to reinvent the basic approaches. And the second thing is to build monitoring, evaluation, and learning into each project from the start so that every step along the way we assess what's going on, we assess whether the impact is being achieved, and we adjust as needed in order to achieve those results. So yeah, to sum it up, we need to learn from what other capacity development experts are doing, and we need to learn from our own mistakes as we go.
Thank you very much, Hanna. Also welcome to those of you that join us a little bit later. This is a session dealing with practical issues connected to capacity development programs. Hanna, admitting mistakes is difficult for each of us individually. It's also difficult for an
conversation, but I think it's an important part of the process. And what I appreciate also in your role in Diplo, you cover capacity development also from the theoretical point of view. We, by the way, have a course in capacity development, which takes it more from the theory. And, you know, trying to integrate some of the theoretical knowledge to the practical programs can be actually quite beneficial. As I said at the beginning of our session, we were supposed to have two remote speakers, but there are some challenges. So one of them, notably Grace Mutungu, will not be able to join us unless the situation evolves. But I would like to welcome Fiji. I would like to welcome Anju Mangal, who should be joining us from a very remote Pacific island. And I'm hoping that that we will soon hear and see her on the screen. She's from the SPC. Anju, can you hear us?
Yes, loud and clear.
Okay, we cannot see you, right? It's not possible to have you.
No, it's only because of connectivity issues, so it might not be visible.
I understand, but Anju, please go ahead. You yourself have a lot of experience with capacity development programs, notably in the Pacific Islands. Please.
Okay, thank you so much, Teresa and Diplo Foundation, for giving me an opportunity to be part of this important session. I believe this is one of the most critical sessions at the IGF, and I keep reiterating this at every IGF. Unfortunately, I couldn't be part of it this time. I represent the Pacific, and like most of you who say that we continue to struggle to attend face-to-face meetings due to lack of funding opportunities, and also because of our geographic location. We are also very geographically dispersed and face the threat of climate change, as you mostly know. So let me tell you about my journey, as this feeds into the title of the session, Challenges of Capacity Development, and I hope to make my speech a bit spicy, as Teresa mentioned earlier. I was fortunate to be part of the Diplo Foundation IG course in 2007 and was part of the Capacity Development Multilateral Initiative, which was funded by the Swiss government. Because of my participation in capacity development, I was then awarded an opportunity to join the IGF Secretariat and work under the supervision of Marcus Kumar and Chengetai. I was also successful ISOC ambassador. I was then given an opportunity to be part of the first Pacific Islander to join the multi-stakeholder advisory group. I continue to push more and more Pacific Islanders, small island states, to participate at IGF and also Diplo-funded meetings and capacity development courses. However, from my point of view, there are always two major obstacles. One is not enough funding to continue supporting more small island states, and then there's not enough buy-in from our governments to support capacity building initiatives in the area of IG or digital policy. And I also think that there's lack of strategic commitment from our leaders to support capacity building interventions in the space of internet governance and digital policy. And in addition to this, I also feel there is a lack of exit strategies to ensure that the donor investment is sustainable in the long term, so that follow-ups can be done. And we continuously face the challenge of making sure that these initiatives are implemented successfully with great results and impact. Hannah mentioned that we continue to make sometimes we do make the same mistakes and we don't really learn from it. And I think it's important that we continue to learn from our mistakes and also to look at what are the challenges for each of the different countries, because we all vary in different capacity, and some of these small island states don't have enough resources or they lack the capacity to maintain or to invest further in capacity development initiatives. So these are some of the challenges that we face, and I do have some recommendations that might be suitable for this forum, but if need be, I can type it. I'm not sure if I have the time or not, Teresa. Thank you.
Anju, thank you. What's the time in Fiji now?
It's 10:45 p.m.
Okay. appreciate even more that you're with us at this hour. But thank you very much for joining us and bringing your very specific expertise and experience from the Pacific Islands, which of course has an additional layer of complexity when it goes to capacity development. Maybe if I can point out one point that you've mentioned, you've also talked about kind of your government and your leaders' role in this, being kind of able to realize that gaps in capacity to cover and follow digital issues are a problem, because here we also are at the point I mentioned at the beginning that the responsibility doesn't necessarily just rely on the outside help, international. It is also an issue that needs to kind of be tackled domestically. So a lot of the work that you do in the islands, working with the local governments there, I think is also a kind of precondition for a more impactful capacity development programs in the field on the ground. So
yes,
thank you, Anju, feel free to jump in anytime, either by voice or by typing, and Marco will pass the message. Thank you for now.
Thank you so much.
And I would like to turn now, and others, feel free to jump in anytime. Yes, we don't need to do it in any particular order if you want to elaborate on any points that have been mentioned, but if not at this minute, I would like to turn to our last resource person, and that's Susan. Susan Telcher is from the International Telecommunications Union, an actor that is more and more active and visible in capacity development debates. So Susan, please, over to you. What do you see as some of the challenges from your experience?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Teresa. Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much, Diplo, to having invited ITU to this session. I'm head of the capacity building division at ITU, so to me this topic is very, very dear, but also for ITU it's one of the core objectives to do capacity building and capacity development in the field of its activities among its membership. So I wanted to actually touch on a specific angle in the debate today, which is about financing capacity development activities. And I would like to share with you a specific model that we have tried in our own work on this, just to throw in a bit of a different perspective on that topic. Because I know a lot of what we are talking here is project funded capacity development activities, project funded by different donors. We talk national, international, the typical donor community, the banks, etc. So we do a lot of that, of course, as well. But I wanted to share with you an example of where we have tried out a different program, where we moved from project funded to self-funding activities in our capacity development work. And this is a specific program that we have had for many years, but 4 years ago we changed the strategy. So it's we call it Centers of Excellence program. And we have globally around 26 centers of excellence that do capacity building in the field of ICT and digital development. These are usually local entities, training entities or universities who are delivering the training, and they are part of this ITU global network. And so in the past it was a project funded program where we basically supported the instructors, some of the travel of the participants, and other activities that were costly. And then the strategy changed, and we moved towards a self-funding model, which started 4 years ago. And the way the centers now work, in fact, first we reduced the number of centers. We had a lot more. So now, as I said, we have 26 operational, mostly in developing countries. And we changed it in a way that now the centers actually charge tuition fees for the training that they deliver. And then that money is used to pay for their own costs. And we also have actually a cost-sharing model between them and ITU, where they keep 80% of the fees and 20% come to us, which we use to support help to maintain the program, and we have an online platform they can use to deliver their courses, etc., etc. So this is now 4 years in place. We are doing now for this cycle the assessment right now. It's been working quite well from the self-sustainability model from what we have seen, but some of them are much more successful than others. There are different challenges that they are facing in this. But for now, I just wanted to share this model, and if there's more time, I'm happy to talk a bit more about some of the success stories or lessons learned. But it's just to throw in another angle on the funding aspect. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Susan. And I think it's very useful because also kind of this this aspect of co-financing your participation in capacity development program. It's also that we are we have big internal debates about this because capacity development programs do cost money, and sometimes we also have the feeling that once you deliver programs for free, as it is perceived, it's actually not for free, because when something is for free, it means somebody else must have covered it, and then when you want to change the model, maybe include some co-financing aspects, it's very challenging. Hannah could probably tell stories about this from Diplo's experience. And at this moment, are there any quick reactions to anything that was said so far? When we were in RightsCon, the second kind of more formal debate on this issue on capacity development and the practical questions, we tried to create an action plan, kind of taking some of the key points that have been resonating in these debates. Actually, it ended up being a 9-point plan, so I'm sure we are missing because there are no 9-point plans, but once the IGF website is up, you know, feel free to go to the session and the background paper is there to be downloaded. Many of the points that we have covered in this 9-pointer have been echoed here at this session. One of the points has not been covered yet, and I'll just quickly read it to you and would invite you to comment. We've talked about how implementers of capacity development programs should be communicating and cooperating and you know, filling in you know, each with their own respective expertise. But what about the donors? So one of the points was donors should talk to each other, share relevant information, and have a dialogue. It could be useful to create a platform for exchanging information and building partnerships. Because not only can there be a lot of duplication kind of in, you know, we do this, we also do this, by the way, and we come across this very often, but what about the donors? If donors do not communicate, maybe one donor finds something, another donor finds the same thing, maybe in the same country, which automatically leads to unwanted competition, maybe even confusion of the recipients of the training or similar programs. Any reactions on that, Alberto? Maybe you're best placed.
My perception is that, unfortunately, in this field, there is not the level of coordination that you may expect or you can see in other fields. When you go to fields like environmental issues, human rights, you see that a number of donors, there is to start a critical mass of donors working on those areas, and there are significant investment in terms of coordinating efforts, and to the point that they are doing, in some cases, joint grant making. But in the field of digital policy, my perception, if I can put in my hand, in this hand, all the donors that are working in Latin America in this area, and I may have too many fingers for Africa. There is not a critical mass of donors to have a significant effort, collective effort. So far, there are, you can see that kind of effort in the US, where we have the net gain, where major donors, MacArthur, Hewlett, Mozilla, Ford Foundation, do join efforts to advance internet policies and to support initiatives in this area, but worldwide, we are in a much more precarious situation where there is no chances to coordinate that much, given the fact that there are just a few or a handful of donors. Let me give you a couple of examples. In the case of Latin America, where we started program making worldwide as for foundation, 4 years ago, there were basically OSF and Ford Foundation. Today, in Latin Latin America, you can find also Midyar, who is about to land with grantmaking in the region, Avina Foundation, a local organization foundation based in Mexico that is actually working in this field. Mozilla has expressed significant interest in landing there, and IDRC, the Canadian Agency of International Cooperation, is also supporting initiatives in the region. 5 donors in the whole region. Do we coordinate? I wouldn't say that coordinate, but we are in close touch. I have been reviewer of many proposals of my colleagues. My colleagues have reviewed proposals that I have received. We try to stay in touch in close conversation to assess our organizations and to determine what are the opportunities that are coming around then during the following days. But I wouldn't say that we have joint efforts yet. So it's my perception. Answering your question, I had the perception that we don't have yet a critical mass of donors working in this field to ask for the level of coordination that we can see in other areas like environmental issues or women's or human rights.
That's I think actually to me your answer is quite reassuring, because you are definitely at least exchanging information. If you're involved in the cross evaluation of the projects, this is out of also like transparency and efficiency. It's very reassuring in my view. So also interesting that you actually highlighted how this field of digital policies is a bit narrower compared to you know, the bigger issues of human rights or climate change. Thank you for that. Susan, I know that the ITU is also active in kind of trying to bring, you know, capacity development providers together and having a discussion in this informal forum, if I may. Can you elaborate a bit on that? What you've been trying to do in your efforts to bring the community together?
Yes, thank you very much, Teresa. Yeah, indeed. We are trying, because there are not a lot of forums where you actually bring all the people together who are active in capacity development. So we work a lot with partners in the field, not only our member states, the governments, but also the private sector is very active, by the way, in that field also. Academic institutions we are trying to bring in, and then other training entities also from the civil society. So we are trying to also have a dialogue among the things that we do is to foster dialogue among these different stakeholders, because we really think it's important that the universities and the private sector talk to each other so that they know what are the demands actually from the market in terms of skills that are needed. So we are trying to bring them together, talk together. The governments need to be there, of course, because of their policy implementation programs. They have to talk to the whole ecosystem in the capacity building or skill development environment. So you have to bring all of these together, and we have a capacity building symposium that we organize. It's a biannual big event where we try to bring all of these different people together to have actually a conversation on what are the current needs in terms of skill development in the field of ICT and digital developments, and who is doing what in order to address those needs. So, and important, as I said, is to have also to hear also from the market, from the private sector, to see what is actually what they need, and have a conversation with the other stakeholders that are in charge of doing capacity building and training.
Thank you, and we will certainly come back to the private sector. Sorry, Marco, I've been missing your WhatsApp messages, but Anju would like to jump in remotely. Anju, over to you.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, perfect. Again, I'd like to speak on behalf of the small island states. I like the cost-sharing approach and co-financing aspect that Susan mentioned earlier, but there are many organizations in small island states that still face challenges in just simply understanding what internet governance is and what digital policy really means. And this is a basic struggle first. I also feel that we may need to establish a joint funding approach to secure more seats for small island developing states, and also look at how this could support the sustainable development goals. This could be a way forward for donors, because they continuously look at the sustainable development goals. And also, it would be good to encourage our donors and partners to invite, again, the small island states to be part of your high level meetings, because so that when you make sound decisions, you are aware of the issues that we face in the small island states. And I would highly encourage, and this would be my final point before I leave, is to have a donor and partner organization roundtable, basically to identify synergies for future capacity development initiatives. And this I call for support for not only small island states, but the entire ACP member countries. I think this would be very appreciated by some of us who are working in the development sector. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Anju. Two points here, also building on what Susan has said. The role of the private sector. We haven't really tackled that, but I think that's another kind of aspect that we do need to take into account. And I don't want to put anybody on the spot. I don't know if there is anybody from the private sector besides you, Deepak, and you've just come, so I don't want to kind of put, and feel free not to talk if you don't want to, but you came here now to a session dealing with practical questions of capacity development. You're representing the private sector, a big company, Symantec. Would you like to see what, from your perspective, and once again, sorry you've missed what we've been discussing before, but why would you as a private sector be interested in capacity development in digital policy? It would be quite useful for us. And sorry for putting you on this.
Thanks, Teresa. So, two things. Number one, I think most of the technology development as well as deployment and design is happening within the private sector. And that's where a lot of capacity is available, and also a lot more capacity is needed there. Second thing is there's a interest of the private sector also that if whatever they develop, any product or services, they should also be used in a proper manner. So for example, it's one thing to develop a good browser with a whole lot of privacy settings, etc., but unless people know how to use those properly, the effect will not be so good, and at times actually it could be even negative. So for example, in India, I work in Symantec, and one of the things that we have done there is we have partnered with NASSCOM, which is India's largest IT industry association, and developed cybersecurity curriculum, and those curriculum have been approved by the National Skill Development Corporation, which is a government body. And now those curricula are available free of cost from NASSCOM, not from Symantec, by the way. So Symantec was one among equals. So we had people from other companies, including tech companies, including banks, including some of the consulting organizations that supervised what is needed, what is being developed. And even the course curriculum, et cetera, was not paratrooped. It got developed grounds up. So what happened that they formed a committee, and in that so they did multiple workshops with people, what type of skills are needed in the 3 to 5 years time frame, and they identified 10 job roles, and we supported 5 of them. And later we also developed another course of 80 hours. Now we are also considering how to put those on the, let's say, on the cloud and make things like that. So I think it's very important for people to not only look at what can be done, but also what should be done and how it should be done. And that's one of the areas that I would say is that it must be voluntary, but at the same time, encourage those type of voluntary movements. Thank you.
Thank you. That was Deepak Maheshwari from Symantec. And yes, I mean, you know, also I can imagine that for the private sector working on technology, you want people know how to use it, but you also want the policymakers to be able to take informed decisions in environments that are regulated, such as this. So, you know, it is connected, and I see this as an entry point why the private sector needs to be at a table for debates like this. One other comment, building on what Anju said, was bringing really this conversation to the high level. What I can say that, for instance, the newly formed high-level panel on digital cooperation, which was established in July, really looks into capacity development, and will, you know, I do expect that the report that is due to be submitted in the spring next year will elaborate quite a lot on capacity development, and I will try to make sure to also also feed in the discussions that we've had around this table to their work. And also, please be aware that until, I think, the 18th of November, you can also send your inputs. So if capacity development is something close to your heart, please do take advantage of that opportunity as well. Now, we are closing the session in a few minutes at the latest, so I wanted to take this opportunity to ask if there are any comments from your experience. Lara, please, that you would still like
to. Thank you. I think we one of the things I just wanted to say before you close the session is there's a lot of focus on securing funding, and we've spoken a lot about donor coordination, which I think is absolutely important. But as implementers of capacity development, one of the things that I don't feel has become normalized in the planning stages of programs or large large projects like three-year projects is the ability to create hooks in our work to enable other organizations, the ones that perhaps we may seem to look like we are in competition with, but actually we're not. So if in our planning stage and in our design stage, we can create these hooks for these other organizations to come in, then A, it helps in terms of that duplication that we're talking about. But it also brings more value to our project in having that long-term, in that drive to establish the long-term change. So I think in terms of collaboration and coordination, which you hear about all the time, it really is down to the implementers when they're designing the programs to create the space for your colleagues to come in.
Yeah, thank you, Lara. Yeah, I think we could all sign that, yeah. If there are no other, Alberto, please.
I think that something that could be interesting to explore in near future, especially as many of us have been engaged in this conversation for a while, is recognizing the fact that we are coming to this conversation from different settings with different interests. Just Angie was talking about having the opportunity to have all the donors in the same room, and probably I have been in many of those meetings with many donors in the room, and everybody's coming from different places. While some of them are working about doing capacity building for purpose of accelerating innovation, other of them are considering, in my case, social justice. In other cases, it's about human rights. And capacity building, the flavor of the capacity building, may be very different if you are working in the same sector with different perspectives. So it's not only where you're coming from, but what do you want to achieve with capacity building. And probably it could be very interesting to be more transparent and upfront about what are our expectations in order to identify how we can move forward together in some instances.
Very important point, Alberto, thank you very much. With this, I would like to thank all the resource people at our session, namely Hannah, Susan, Alberto, Anju, remotely, and Jorge. I would also like to thank Katarina Hene, who is preparing a report from this session that will be online on the Digital Watch Observatory, dig.watch, within 2 hours. If she's quick, maybe even earlier. I would like to thank Marco Lotte, our remote moderator, who was making sure that we get everybody remotely safely in the session. And thank you very much for being here. Let's continue this conversation and keep in touch. Have a good IGF. Thank you.